It's very clear then that in order for us to study sinusoids, we'll need to study functions of the form cos theta plus j sine theta. So this is because that's in fact the vector that we care about. The terminology is, this is called the real part and this is called the imaginary part of the complex number. So this is called a complex number, which has a real and imaginary part. And so if this number is going to be C, then we'd say that the real part of C is going to be cos theta, and the imaginary part of C is sine theta. There's one very important way of representing this. So instead of saying cos theta plus j sine theta, we can call this, we can write it as e to the power j theta. So you might say, what's that now? You know, we're taking the natural number, natural value e, and we're exponentiating it to an imaginary, this is an imaginary, or I should put it in quotes, imaginary value j, and then theta is the angle. What does it mean? And to be honest, it doesn't really matter. This particular identity, which is called Euler's identity, can be proved mathematically. But for us, it's just shorthand. It just says, whenever we want to write down cos theta plus j sine theta, we'll just say e to the power j theta. And so you should always think of it as being just a shorthand for a rotation by theta of a particular phasor, the phasor being the rotating vector. So this particular identity allows us to explain things quite easily if we add one more thing, if we add things over here, for example, a e to the j theta, and this means that we have the disk that we talked about earlier has a radius of a, so it's the scalar that we're multiplying the rotating vector, the phasor, by. So that's the phasor that's rotating like this, and that is given by a to j theta. And just to make things a bit convenient for later, when we say a e to the power minus j theta, that means we have a phasor that's rotating in this direction. So the red phasor is this one that's rotating like this. And when you have a negative angle, it means you're rotating like that. Again, it's just notational convenience as far as we are concerned. Just to give an example of this, let's say we want to look at e to the power j pi by 2. What does it mean? Well, that just means cos pi by 2 plus j sine pi by 2. And we know that this is going to be 0 and sine pi by 2 is 1, so this is just j. So that's an example of what how we can use this particular formula. We can also sum up things that are in this form. So if you want to look at, for example, e to the power j pi by 10 plus 2e to the power minus j 2 pi by 10, we just expand each one separately. This is going to be cos pi by 10 plus j sine pi by 10 minus, so that's sorry, plus twice cos minus 2 pi by 10 plus j sine minus 2 pi by 10. And these are just numbers. These are just physical quantities. You can look them up in the table. And this turns out to be 2.568 plus j 1.484. So this quantity, which looks quite complicated, is just this particular vector over here. And that gives an example of how we can use Euler's formula to represent mathematical operations on phasors. So in this case, I've added two phasors. This is adding two phasors. And here I'm going from a phasor representation I'm going, sorry, from the compact representation to this expanded representation over here, which is e to the j theta equals cos theta plus j sine theta, is for any value of theta, and in particular, theta could be a time-varying quantity, such as 2 pi over t times t, so where t is time. So if this means that, in this case, the theta, the angle made by the phasor, which is changing like so, is that's represented that this value theta over here. This is varying over time. And as time advances, the angle keeps changing, just as we'd seen before. We're going to give this a specific value. We're going to call this omega. So we will say theta equals omega t, right? So if theta equals omega t, then from our perspective, when we write over here, we say the phasor is written in the form e to the power j omega t, and this is going to be cos omega t plus j sine omega t. And so omega t is can be thought of omegas can be thought of as being the frequency. It's omega is the frequency over here, and it has units of per time, which is time inverse, because you can see it's 1 over capital T, which is the time quantity. So it has frequency units of 1 per time, per unit time. And so here we're saying it's cos of the angular frequency omega multiplied by time plus j times the sine of the angular frequency omega multiplied by time. The real part of this is going to be cos omega t. So to be more precise, the real part of, let me see if I can get rid of that. That wasn't a great idea. Okay, let's forget that. So the real part of e to the power j omega t is going to be cos omega t, which is just what we wanted as the projection of the phasor onto the x-axis. So if I draw this more cleanly, here we have the rotating phasor like this, which is making an angle theta with the x-axis. And the projection of this over here is given by the real part of e to the j omega t. Okay. And if you want to make this having an angle value a, which is then this is going to be a times the real value of j omega t. So that is in fact what we want over here, what we show over here. A couple of formulas are useful if you want to go from one representation to the other. So let's say we have a complex number a plus jb. So, for example, 5 plus j 10, and I want to represent that using Euler's formula as in the form c e to the power j theta. Then we can say that c equals square root of a square plus b square, and theta equals tan inverse b over a. And this is very, very obvious when immediately when you draw the angle over here and you show this theta, and this is a plus jb. So obviously from Pythagoras' theorem, this is square root of a square plus b square. So that's the length of the vector, the magnitude of the vector. So that's over here, c. And then theta is just tan inverse b over a. So you get that right away. And so this identity allows us to go from the complex number representation to the Euler compact representation quite easily. But already we know enough to be able to do something pretty interesting, which is how to take the real part of the of this value over here. So let's say we'll focus on this quantity over here, real part of c e to the power j omega t, and we want to see how to represent sinusoid. So let's say I want to represent a zero bit by sinusoid like this, and a 1 bit by a larger sinusoid like that, which differ only in amplitude. Then all we need to do is to say the first one is C1, real part of C1, e to the j omega t, And the second one, let's say that's this one over here, that's amplitude C1, and the second one is real part of C2 e to the power j omega t. And let's say that is a magnitude C2, and you can see that just these two simple things tell us how to do what's called amplitude shift keying. We could also play around with frequencies. So we could say 0 is this, and then 1 is a higher frequency thing. It goes with a higher frequency, the same amplitude. Well, that's just going to be the real part of some value C e to the power j omega 1 t, and this is going to be the real part of C e to the power j omega 2 t. And so that makes it pretty easy to represent that. And then if you want to look at what's called phase shift keying, so in phase shift keying, let's say this is time. So when we want to send a 0, we send this value here. We want to send a 1, I'll show it in black. We're going to, let's say, shift it like this. And so it's shifted by, let's say, pi by 2. Then you can see that one of them is going to be the real part of e to the power j omega t, and the other one will be real part of e j omega t plus pi by 2, for example, and that's shifting it by 90 degrees. So we can see that this representation of the phasor allows us to do very simple mathematical descriptions of some of the fundamental ways in which we are able to manipulate sinusoids in order to send bits across a wire. A bit of useful sort of mathematical algebra which is helpful. So e to the j theta is cos theta plus j sine theta, and e to the minus j theta is going to be therefore cos of minus theta plus j sine of minus theta, which is the same as cos theta, because it's the same for positive and negative values, minus j sine theta, because sine goes is not the same for positive and negative values. So if you take a look at this, and we look at this plus this, so you can say e to the j theta plus e to the minus j theta is equal to 2 cos theta, which means e to the j theta plus e to the minus j theta over 2 is equal to cos theta. And similarly, it's easy to show that e to the j theta minus e to the minus j theta over 2j is equal to sine theta. And so these two identities over here are often helpful when we work with phasors.